architect and poet from Mumbai, Shri Ranjit Hoskote. We are extremely grateful to him for having taken the time and trouble to be here with us this evening. The senior architect, Dr. Geeti Sen, has agreed to chair the session. She is a very esteemed authority on art, and we are sure that her presence lends both grace and prestige to this evening. Copal Art is a young organization aimed at broad-basing the existing collectors of art and adding many more to it. As part of our social responsibility, we are organizing this monthly series of talks on single works of art by a cross-section of persons of eminence, expertise and involvement. We already have acceptance of art critics like Dr. Geeti Sen, Srimati Rubina Karoe, Shri Pranav Ranjan Ray, Shri Parag Shukla, theatre person Neelam Mahal Singh, art historian Dr. B. N. Goswami, art historian and academician Dr. Jyotindra Jain, Hindi poet Udayan Bajpayee, and editor Om Thambi. Copal has also instituted 11 fellowships of rupees 1 lakh each for young art historians and architects for carrying out projects on specific artists, trends or periods. They are being named after pioneers such as Nisim Askade, Karan Khanwala, Richard Batham Lumbu, Krishna Chaitanya, J. Swaminathan, etc. Copal is recommending well-documented books on major art centers of India as commencing these books, namely Mumbai, Delhi, Baroda, Kolkata and Shantiniketan, Bhopal, etc. After the talk, then before the remarks of the chairperson, there will be some time for discussion.
Commend the initiative taken by Copal, because I think that one of the most important things that the initiative that has been started by Mr. Seth and Sri Ashok Bajpayee is something that I have to confess I was thinking of doing, and it was wonderful that in fact it actually within a week of my suggesting it to the India International Center, it was wonderful, it was ironical that I got a letter inviting me to give a talk also in this series. I commend it because I think it is the best way to go, because it is looking in depth at one piece of work and looking in depth at the work of one artist rather than being a run-through as is often done. And in that sense, I think Ashok Bajpayee and Mr. Seth have taken a new direction which needs to be done. We couldn't have a better person than Ranjit Hoskote to do this, because in fact, Ranjit Hoskote had done exactly that, and I was sitting with him, what was it, 3-4 years ago, at the Sondaria conference here, at the conference room 2 in the main building, where at the Sondaria conference, each one of us read a paper. But it was Ranjit Hoskote who alone chose to speak on one painting. And he also, at that time, chose to speak on Atul, Dodiya. So what we have here today is actually going to be an exercise that has continued in research from earlier work of his. I may add that my first introduction to Ranjit Hoskote, when I get to that, but my first introduction to him in writing was another article, a brilliant, illuminating essay that he wrote in Gallery International, and that was on Gandhi. And what was it called? An artist. In? Of nonviolence. So that particular piece which was on Gandhi and exploring Atul Dodiya's work again, shows us that Ranjit Hoskote has in fact spent considerable time working on the work of perhaps one of the most outstanding artists. If I were to choose an artist from Bombay today to speak on, I would also probably choose Atul Dodiya as being one of the most brilliant minds and subversive minds. And I cannot wait to hear what Ranjit Hoskote has to say about this painting, which is again, something that Atul Dodiya has done before, that is that he interprets, he brings his own interpretation to an earlier theme. In this case, it is Raja Ravi Varma. So I hold that in suspense because I don't know what Ranjit is going to say. We've only just met now at the table in this room about 10 minutes ago. I'd just like to mention, in terms of the background of Ranjit Hoskote, that we first met at a very wonderful and memorable place which used to exist in Bombay, in Kalaghoda, called the Wayside Inn. Our introduction was through Richard Lanoy, who told me about him and told him about me. And those were the days, not so long ago, when there was time for a lot more leisured conversation. And we talked, I think, for 2 hours. We met for a cup of coffee and we sat and talked for 2 hours. But Ranjit Hoskote belongs to Bombay. He has his degree in political science from the University of Bombay. And he went on to study further the aesthetics of literature. He was for a short time visiting Cambridge, which is where, at the time when he met Lanoy. And he has, since I met him, at the time when I met him, he brought me his first book on Jahangir Sabhawala. And now he has 5 books out on contemporary art. 2 on Jahangir Sabhawala, one of which was very, very well released here at the National Gallery of Modern Art. Another book on Jahangir Sabhawala, the earlier one, which was Pilgrim, Exile, Sorcerer. A book on Sudhir Patwardhan, a book on Baiju Parthan, and a book on Irana. Apart from that, of course, Ranjit is a poet, and I think what he brings to his critique of paintings is a poetic disposition. It's a poetic disposition that makes you sit up, makes me sit up, and look at the words and savor them. That is not to say that he doesn't offer us, he doesn't beguile us with words, he doesn't assault us with words, but he has very penetrating insights. We have, of course, several poets in the tradition of art criticism in India, and I would name Nissen Ezekiel, Richard Bartholomew, and Keshav Malik among them. But I think Ranjit Hoskote goes a step further, because it is his interpretation of an artist's interpretation of an early work. So we are here looking at a multi-layered presentation. I won't stand between you now and Mr. Ranjit Hoskote. Please, let's welcome him to today. Thank you.
Generous introduction. And I may have said this before, but I love lengthy introductions, not out of fetching vanity, but simply because it puts off the moment when I have to go on and say my piece. But here we are, not going to be much of it. But let me begin more formally by saying how happy I am to be here, and how grateful to Kopal, to Mr. Seth, and to Ashok Vajpayee for having made this platform possible. Because then I will go on to talk about this in a minute. It's truly very important for us to be looking at singular works of art and talking about them. Because I suspect that we are in the middle of some kind of crisis in the Indian art world. Which of course seems like an apocalyptic remark at a point when everybody is talking about the boom and how well everybody seems to be doing. But I think it is that boom and that emphasis on the market, which by its nature emphasizes generic volumes, productivity, and all the rest of it. It is because of that we are perhaps moving away from the experience of the individual singular work of art. I think crucially there has been an overemphasis on the commodity nature of the artwork, partly because that is the way the rhythm of the market goes, partly also because of the kind of writing that is now very current on the arts. Right? The interest in that kind of writing seems to be on prices, the value of such a thing as a Bach concerto. Now, this piece of music can exist in various avatars or forms or states of being, if you like, me. I just invite you, before we get down to Atul, to think about what different sorts of avatars that Bach concerto can have. On the one hand, it could be a score, just a set of notations on a piece of paper. That's the basic form. It could also be a performance, a live occasion, particularities of performance and reception. It could also be a recording, which really is just a set of electronic impulses in a retrieval system, which can be activated at the press of a key or a switch. It's potential. Or you could hum it, you could slow it, you could tap your fingers to its rhythm, you could do all kinds of things. At all events, the point I'm trying to make is that the Bach concerto, or things like it, have a certain status as a mental experience, which can amplify and enhance the consciousness of the experiencer. And I'm trying to see how we could possibly connect this idea to what goes on in the visual arts. When I think of how works of contemporary visual art are received, how they're understood, or as might be misunderstood, it seems to me that we have a very strange situation, what Woody Allen might have called a very definite type of situation, which is that it exists, the contemporary work of visual art exists in two registers. On the one hand, there is a widespread belief that it is a relatively difficult or inaccessible cultural production, which has a private meaning for the artist. This is honored and respected, the private meaning for the artist. On the other hand, there is the awareness that it has a certain economic meaning. There is a value in terms of price that is attached. That also is honored and respected. But what falls between these two, the private meaning and the economic meaning, I suspect, is an intermediate realm where there is such a thing, or could be such a thing, as a shared social meaning. What is the shared social meaning of an artwork when we go to an exhibition, when the eye dwells, fixes on a particular work of art? How do we make some kind of meaning, all of us together, actors in the art world? How do we actually produce a meaning that we can all share? Whether it's a painting, or a work, or an installation, or a video work, it seems to me that apart from specialist writing, specialist discussion of certain kind, we don't have that intermediate realm of discussion. And I'd suggest that it is really only by talking about works, meaning as a system of conversations. And as you know, artworks and their changing valencies gain significance only from being situated in that conversation, which is the artwork. So, I want to take these thoughts further as I go to this painting. But I also want us to sort of recommit ourselves to the idea that reading a painting, and you have to read a painting quite often, and that really calls for a certain amount of work on the part of the viewer. And I think that again is something that many of us, not practitioners, but many viewers are probably in danger of forgetting that. I also want to put in place the notion of delight, and maybe we can come back to that look at it and you go off in a state of delight. I'm worried by that kind of idea of delight. I mean, what sort of delight is it other than a vague pleasure? And I'll just place before you this idea that it's really an engagement. We'll go on now to posit conversation, such as the one we're having here, as a mode of active ownership. And it suits my particular kind of anarchist politics to take that line, but think about it. One person may physically own a painting, this painting, for instance, but any number of viewers can walk away carrying it in their imaginations. It's a kind of copyleft, it's a kind of benign piracy, but it's also the only way in which art has made meaning to many, many more people than people who own artworks. So having said that, I want to say that for these reasons, I'm particularly delighted to be standing here not in the presence of a physical artwork, an object, the so-called original, but indeed in the presence of this spectral image, this projection of Atul Dodiya's 1998 painting. I tried to, because as Ethi was saying, Atul is an artist who's very dear to me. So I have tried over the years. It's intrigued me. Its meanings have changed for me during the last nearly 10 years that have passed since it was conceived and committed to canvas. to share with you the basic details, which many of you are probably familiar with, but just so we're all on the same page. The painting was first shown at the Vadera Art Gallery as part of Atul's solo exhibition there in March, April of 1999. And I first saw it in Atul's studio in late 1998, really as a charcoal tracery. So this is, so to speak, the afterlife of the painting, and I remember seeing it when it was actually just a prefigured shape. And then I saw it again in June 2001, because it was one of the artworks that I chose, one among 41 paintings and sculpture installations that I chose when I curated the mid-career retrospective of Atul for the Japan Foundation in Tokyo. And the collector very graciously lent the work to us for the occasion. So standing in the middle of that exhibition was like looking at old friends and seeing how they had aged or whether they had improved or what had gone wrong or how amazingly splendid they looked, whereas at first they might have seemed a bit strange. To me, Gangavataran is an iconic work. It dramatizes for me the many questions that spring up in relation to the activity of image making. And these are questions that certainly I know preoccupy many of us, but I find myself constantly asking them when I'm in the presence of artworks. And I put these before you. My first question would be, what kind of semiotic proposition does a painting make? What kind of reading strategies does a painting demand? Or what kind of reading strategies does a painting supply us with? And as we go into the reading in detail, I hope to be able to relay some of these questions and talk about them. Also, I'm always struck by the manner in which the paintings that most excite us are also playing a game. They play games with language, they play games with reception. So a question I would also ask is, what sorts of games does a painting play with its particular historic context? How does it play with the expectations of its audience? How does it push reception? How does it second guess what you have in mind when you come to it? And what place does it occupy in the constantly switching and re-switching circuit between high art and expressive culture, between political concerns and the poetics, the private idiosyncratic poetics of the artist? With these thoughts in mind, let's go to the painting and see if we can tap into some of the drama that animates it. I have here a laser pointer, which is a deadly thing, I believe, if you pointed at someone's eye when you test it. Most of us are probably completely familiar with I think, along with three different paintings. The basic episode, topos, theme, if you like, is in fact the descent of Ganga, the celestial river, brought down by Bhagirath, the royal sage, in order to redeem his ancestors. A Ravi Varma painting, which I'll talk about in half a second. And there is set in rather shocking, amazing relation to the Ravi Varma painting, there is the 1912 nude descending the staircase of Marcel Duchamp, which has replaced the Ganga in this particular composition. There are really four elements. There's the Ravi Varma tableau, there's the Marcel Duchamp insertion, there's Dodiya as a celebratory shadow, and there is this fourth element, which is a late Duchamp self-portrait, which I'll come to as we go down. If this were formal and the sorts of contexts or milieu that they come from and the kinds of, if you like, condensed narratives they are. So to run through that, the Ravi Varma painting was originally an oil painting, late 19th century, and it was vastly circulated, as we all know, as an oleograph. It's appeared in advertisements, it's appeared in posters, political materials, reproductions of all kinds, and it's had a very pan-Indian circulation. And interestingly, it's one of the images, it was probably one of the very first images that Atul ever saw as a child, because where he grew up, and he really is, he began, and in many ways is still very much a neighborhood artist. He's committed to where he lives. Even though his works are viewed all over the world now, to him, the base, the root, and the space of being is his studio in suburban Ghatkopar, in a very interesting space, which is like a village in the heart of the metropolis. And the studio that he works in used to be his childhood home. So when he went to sleep as a child, there were these rows of framed oleographs above his head. And you can think of how at the age of 4, 5, 6, 7, that's what he went to sleep looking at, and that's what he, when he woke up, that's the first thing he saw. So in many ways, Raja Ravivarma was part of the personal visual culture of the artist growing up. And in many ways stands also, I suspect, as an iconic marker of his childhood, in particular visual experiences of his childhood. The Duchamp comes from another part of Atul's life. And again, a little note on that painting, and we know this, but just again, so that we're all on the same page. This particular work was uproariously rejected by Duchamp's contemporaries, the new Descending the Staircase when it was first shown. And looking back at it, you wonder why, because it seems like a marvelous way of for the artist to connect his interests in analytical cubism with his interests in cinema. Now, these subtle, sharp, susurrating planes that stand in for a body, stand in for motion, and the whole problem of how to represent motion in, by definition, static medium like oil painting, how does that get done? But these experiments of Duchamp's were not looked upon with great favor, even by his brothers, actually, as you know, his contemporaries. And that's what sent Duchamp off, out of painting and into the conceptual thought experiments for which he's now far better known and has become a major figure. But Duchamp, as I was saying, comes to Atul at another point in his life. It's something that he arrives at when he goes to the JJ School of Art to do his BFA. So it's part of his socialization into the art world. It's part of his getting a grip on the many, many other possibilities in art beyond Ravivarma, beyond the oleograph, beyond the sort of drawing one does to get into art school. So, in some sense, this painting, Atul's text, if you like, engages with these two parts of his life. His childhood, iconic, in some sense, a certain innocence attached to that. And over against that are the fruits of growing up, the fruits of an art education. And of course, there's also a certain very intriguing and exciting friction between the world of the popular image and the domain of the avant-garde image. So what happens when you have something like the Ravivarma that comes out of evidently widely shared cultural significance, and that gets placed over against the Duchamp, which speaks of a rupture, speaks of a break with all that is shared, which speaks of what happens when the artist moves beyond the edge of what is acceptable and what is widely understood. So what is the gesture? I'm very interested in what sort of polemical gesture is going on in this artwork. And in some ways, I would read this painting as a sort of mission statement, if you like, for Atul as he was in the late 90s. It's melded from two iconic works, one usually popular. And again, I'd like to say at this point that the two paintings that Atul converses with in this painting have gone through very peculiar histories, in the sense that Nama Nahuja, welcome aboard. Okay. But back to what I was saying. The Ravivarma began in some sense as a marker of taste, if you like, of a certain refined understanding of one's own culture. It very rapidly went into the world of kitsch, was greatly reproved and rebuked by all kinds of people, from Balendranath Tagore to other nationalists to later critics to the pioneering spirits of the indigenously acquired modernism of Shantiniketan, the progressives, and possibly even Jaiswaminathan in his manifesto for Group 1890. So Ravivarma has always been the favorite target, until a certain critical re-evaluation and re-estimation took place in the course of the 90s. And now he's been re-enshrined in some ways, both in the worlds of high art and in the worlds in the world of culture studies, if you like. So that is the peculiar history of the Varma image. And the peculiar history of the Duchamp image is that it was scoffed at, rejected brutally, and sort of put out of circulation. And now, of course, it's venerated as one of the outstanding sort of beginnings of a certain sort of postmodernism. So those are, so all of these three paintings, meaning the Ravi Varma, the Dushama, and the Dodiya, mark a specific gesture of crisis or breakthrough. Ravi Varma's Gangavataran embodies his strategic linkage of European neo-pastoral and academic history painting with Indic, specifically Hindu mythological subjects, through which Ravi Varma produced an art that could express an idea of Indian culture or Hindu civilization or an opulent indigenous past, call it what you will. It is, of course, a matter of historical record that these sorts of images have lent themselves to revivalist schemes in the decades that have passed. But if you take a snapshot of what was going on at the end of the 19th century in colonial India, it's possible to read what Ravi Varma was doing almost as a kind of resistance through complicity. And there's a certain resistance to a visual regime which carries with it implicitly the idea of the superiority of the Western image. So here's a kind of complicity that says we can use some of these materials and we can develop a sense of ourselves. So that's, of course, as I was saying, that sense of oneself eventually turns into something quite monstrous and chimerical. But I will pick up that thread a little later. The Duchamp painting marks another kind of crisis. As I've said before, it for him, this work marked a linkage between his interests in analytical cubism and cinema, and really what was a lifelong preoccupation with Duchamp, which was the representation of the infinitive, the smallest possible movement, the smallest possible duration of time. How does one represent that? So in many ways, that painting, the 1912 work, could be seen as marking that specific linkage. And the rejection of it by his peers led him to reject it and to turn to self-encryption, all of which would then peak in the postmodern revolutions from the late 1950s onwards. And what then is the crisis of the biographical reading of what was going on? I know that 8 years is not a very long time in which to begin to assess biographical motives, but the period, both for individual artists and for the art scene in general, at the end of the 90s, was of very particular interest. So I will take this biographical interest in what was happening to Atul. I would choose to see it as the testament of a beleaguered painter. He was 39 when he painted it, and I'm never sure whether that is young or whether that is mid-career, because in India, as we all know, politicians of about 69 are described as young in the rising generation. So everybody else is 100 or so. But a young painter, I don't know, 39, I would probably, considering that Atul's career starts off in the late 80s, I suppose one could call him a painter who was young and edging towards mid-career. But he was a painter at a point when the center of gravity seemed to be moving towards video, installation, digital media, photography. And painting, although as it were the most prevalent form, the most available form, had suffered a measure of critical eclipse. Also at that time globally, not only in India, but particularly elsewhere. It was also the period when, as I like to think of them, it was the beginning of the arrival of the parachute curators. Any number of curators coming in to get a sense of what was going on in Indian art, being duly shocked that half of it was derivative and the other half was incompetent or whatever they had in mind, forgetting completely that there were very powerful motivations, impulses, lineages that were being dramatized here, and that what was needed was a context different from the one normally assumed for, if you like, Western art. Fortunately, all this has changed. But in the late 90s, artists like Atul actually did suffer a certain crisis of direction, of choice, of whether they were doing the right thing. And it called for a considerable measure of integrity not to leap into novelty for its own sake, and to see if the painted surface could in any way be revitalized. So the prospect of being a painter, and one strongly encoded with regional and private references, as well as a sophisticated wit, sense of hyperbole, and versatility, was a daunting one. So a lot of that gets dramatized in this painting, and indeed in the other 14 that went with it in that particular exhibition of 1999. Actually, the title that I chose to give the essay that I wrote to go with these paintings was an autobiography in 15 frames. So it seemed to me that there was an unbelievable overflow of feeling but put out in the most refined way. And here was a painter who was looking to link his expressive gifts with a criticality and to make a statement about where he was, what he was going through. In some ways, the most romantic thing an artist could do, to talk of his pain, tell me of your pain. But it was done in a way that rippled out and connected with larger historical and cultural themes. And I think that is why works like these are exciting pictorial fictions, especially in a world that seems to be shifting towards other concerns. I also want to point out at this point that all these three paintings that are doing this little choreography in that particular frame mark three distinct regimes of visuality, if you like, by which I mean nothing more forbidding than that. Atul is looking at three very different sorts of ways of representing, ways of making images. And of course, it's easy to forget sometimes when one gets carried away by intertextuality, that especially in visual arts, that what you're quoting is not just a quotation, you're actually remaking it, you're retracing it. So it's not the original. It is what you already in the act of rendering it have made your own, and with specific reasons. So as the ground of this painting, Atul picks up on the naturalism of Ravi Varma's manner, along with its, what I see as its peculiar domestication of the sacred. I mean, this is in many ways a sort of family scene. There's Shiva waiting to receive Ganga, there's Parvati, and sort of domestication. I mean, anthropomorphism is one of those words that lend themselves to all kinds of readings. But when the divine gets placed in this kind of context of family, home, region, look at this scene. Our eyes are not the eyes that first saw Ravi Varma. So we're bringing to it also all that we have accreted and picked up along the way as visual cues. But also there is, even after all these years of knowing this work, I still remain shocked by the key gesture of displacement that lies more or less at the center of the work. When Dodiya displaces Ganga with Duchamp's machine age nude, which is made up of these serial saturating planes, figure, almost a figure by allusion. And once again, certainly to my eye, recovered practically in a kind of SF, sort of science fiction kind of mode. So again, that forms a certain peculiar regime of visuality that is being proposed to us. And of course, Atul places his own shadow on the surface with arms upraised, in some sense in mimicry of Bhagirath from the Ravi Varma. So what is being proposed? The artist as sage king, as initiator of miracles, as patient engineer of the marvelous. I think in that gesture, seeming a very, very simple gesture of being there, he passes from being a collector of quotations to something more powerful. He stakes a claim to possessing these earlier images. He also makes a claim to multiple ancestry, through, as it were, appropriating the afterlife, what Warburg might have called the Nachleben of Ravi Varma, as well as of Duchamp. And I'm stopping over for this Nachleben idea briefly, because the notion that earlier motifs or gestures or images might suddenly have great meaning to one, and that one might recover them, retrieve them in some powerful way, is actually at the center of this work of Atul's, which is why I'm always a bit disturbed when his work gets described under the rubric of pop art, or sometimes absurdly it's even been thought of as kitsch. So these are extraneous incidental details. I think that the main issue here is how do you make a self, a contemporary Indian self, that is multiple, that's kaleidoscopic, that is hybrid, richly hybrid. And of the action of the painting, but it is the key thematic. The celestial river descends to purify long dead sinners. A machine figure descends by substitution to shock us into epiphany. But above all, it is the artist who declares before us his claim to a multiple descent. He creates a genealogy here in this painting, or through this painting for himself. He announces himself to be the inheritor, not of a single, pure, unique, uncontaminated past, but is heir to diverse pasts, to different pasts, coming from different geographical points of origin. And indeed, he announces himself to us as an individual who can choose positions rather than an individual who would be boxed into an identity prescribed for him by ideologues, by politicians, by influential cranks. And again, I would invite you to look at the historical context when this painting was painted. It was a courageous gesture to make this kind of announcement in the late 90s, because after all, Dodiya had figuratively broken and entered into a tableau depicting a Hindu mythological situation. You will all recognize, of course, that it's not just a Hindu mythological situation. It actually comes from the family story of Rama. A certain kind of perverted image of Rama was, as we all know and have suffered, the leitmotif of Hindutva and reactionary formations through the 90s. And this story is an extra-local story. It comes from the family history of Rama. And to do this, to break and enter such a tableau, to make this kind of statement, even if I know critics would say, well, this was all going on in the white cube. But as we know, what happens in the gallery or in the art academy is no longer confined to it. It ripples out, it invites responses through the public sphere. So I would insist that this is a courageous gesture to have made in a period overshadowed by the extremely violent Hindutva upsurge. And a lot of this work of Atul's, when you look at it, you realize that it took place in a 10-year period that was bracketed by Ayodhya, 1992, and Gujarat, 2002. And again, when I go to this painting with these thoughts, it suddenly occurs to me that, you know, Bhagirath is doing a very particular kind of thing here. He is bringing his ancestors to life, and that is as straightforward a description as you can have of revivalism. I won't labor that point, but it strikes me as being of some interest. So what I've been trying to get at is that in many ways, Atul's Gangavataran after Raja Ravi Varma is a painting that takes the form of an argument. It's a painting that encodes autobiography. It's also a painting that makes, if you like, a political statement. And I say all this to retrace what I was saying at the beginning about the Bach concerto, that paintings like works of music can exist in different forms. They can have very different meanings, and we can construct them very differently depending on who we are. And as we saw earlier, there is not one, but two Duchamp works cited and integrated into it. And I want to dwell a little on that one as I conclude. This is Duchamp at the far end of three or four representations in which he played with this idea of himself as a humorist, as a critic, as someone who could rip through the surface of politics. And this is Duchamp having gone through his ready-mades, his thought experiments, and in some ways reclaiming what it meant to draw again, what it meant to produce a certain sort of graphic image, and not make a conceptual provocation. And I think that when you look at the rest of the Dodiya painting, the rest of this marvelous painting, that ghost, that specter of Duchamp becomes the joker, the vidushak, if you like, in this painting, which is an argument, an autobiography, and also a lexicon. And it leads me to think that there could have been another title, actually, to this painting. Atul could easily have called it Gangavataran after Marcel Duchamp. Because in many ways, what he does is to state his right to use all the available Duchampian weapons, humor as critique, the idea that one can work with ready-mades. In this case, the two anterior paintings are ready-mades, or the three actually anterior paintings or works of art are ready-mades, which Dodiya presses into service for his own purposes. A practice aligned with a certain sort of postmodernist, if you like, strategy, but which I think has purposes beyond that, beyond playfulness, beyond disruption alone. And crucially, I think what Dodiya takes from Duchamp is the need to explode all the fixities and stabilities of identity. You do that by multiplying possible identities, by pluralizing meaning, by making sure that the meaning of a painting is never stable, and that the meaning is always made by shuttling around possibilities. And I'll conclude by making a brief reference to what I think Atul's project has really been, and in many ways through the 90s and the early years of the 21st century, this is what he was doing. He was looking at possibilities that could have ended up merely in playfulness or in disruption or in a certain re-evaluation of the role, the relationship of the artist to the audience. But he took up these strategies with something very serious in mind. A, to revitalize the picture surface, which of course Duchamp had rejected. So it's amusing that those strategies were brought in to see if painting could be revitalized. But also to see if a genre like history painting, which had gone into much disrepute with Ravi Verma type productions, to see if that sort of genre could be brought back into active use as a politically critical practice, whilst also being expressively rich. So I think that there are all of these different dialogues, soliloquies, conversations that are going on within this painting. And I've tried to place some of them with questions more than answers. And thank you very much for your patience and your attention.
We can take 2, 3 back questions. I suggest that they are germane to the topic that was discussed. Yes.
Thank you very much, Ranjit, for a very, very evocative reading of this painting. I hadn't looked at the silhouette figure of the artist because there's an ambiguity. You don't know whether he has his back facing it or his front. So it could be both, decommodifies art. I mean, I was not very clear about what argument you're trying to make.
Thanks, Bob. No, maybe I wasn't about to be read through. So I don't mean that merely by reading a work of art one automatically decommodifies all of art. What I mean is that there seems to be a general perception. People talk of A. Jovian Chaudhary. You know, you want to say, what on earth is A. Jovian Chaudhary? I mean, there are paintings of different kinds, there are different ratios of medium that the artist might use. Or they talk of an Atul Dodiya. I am worried by that kind of commodification, where you suggest that anything by the hand of the artist is pretty much the same thing. So what this is really an appeal for close reading, for reading in detail. So, and I genuinely think whether it's in the visual arts or music or literature, it's that kind of reading in detail, which is something like a devotion, which in fact is a devotion, which makes us take the work of art, the labor and the grace of making art seriously, instead of treating these things as generic volumes, as I say, that can be hoovered up. And it's really a call for a certain kind of attention and attentiveness, which I suspect will at least allow us to be aware of the dangers of commoditization.
Yeah.
Sorry, does that answer your question?
I'm actually, there's this double meaning in that shadow, and I find that very intriguing.
It can be, yeah, but that again, in any case, there is not a single past there to be celebrated. So what is being celebrated is the melding of pasts and the agency of the artist who can do such a thing, or make such a claim.
Would it also not add to the commodity value of this commodity at the market is there?
I don't know if any of us have a serious argument against a well-informed market. I don't know if any of us can have a serious argument against a well-informed market. So I think a lot of our positions over many years have involved pro-market or anti-market, which I tend to think is a little very charmingly innocent. So we need to maybe look at ourselves and the things we produce as having many different registers, and we're all economic beings. There's no running away from that. Works of art, by the very fact that they are in an economic situation, are at one level economic objects. So I think our energies will probably be far better spent in trying to create some sort of, if you like, understanding among the different motives. Because there's a very bizarre kind of faux Brahmanism that afflicts our cultural sector. We want to run away from the fact that many things actually have economic value.
Thank you.
But they also have great cultural value. They are open to interpretation. There's all kinds of things going on. So maybe we should learn to see if each one of these identities of an object can have some kind of dialogue with the other.
Prasanna, yes.
You talked about the radicalism in its meaning, but I find it very radical pictorially. Do you accept it, do you like it, or do you don't like it?
Meaning? Do I personally like it?
Well, no. It's you know, you talk more about the radicalism of the meaning, the several layers of meanings in it. But for me, it looks pictorially radical, which is a bit...
I think it probably is just a function of the fact that we're using different vocabularies to talk about the same thing. I mean, what you would call pictorial radicalism or radicality is what I spoke of as intriguing friction among different regimes of visuality. Incredibly brass and studied words, but we're saying the same thing, essentially. You have to forgive these lapses that I occasionally make. But the point is that there are three marvelous ways of picture making going on there, or four, if you like. And it's the contention among them that gives the pictures charge and resonance. So we're effectively saying the same thing.
Yes. Sorry, could you give a name, please?
Hi, my name's Anu, and I want to check, Ranjit. I like the idea of what you said about building an environment to have an informed audience. In that direction, do you have any thoughts to share of how one can, we will not have the privilege of having you around each time to take us through, but how should one develop these kind of sensibilities, if I may say, to really understand the journey of the artist, which would help us appreciate his perceptions and his creative expressions.
Which actually I think is a two-part question. But let me just see if I can address all the points you've made. For one, I have a feeling when we talk of the journey of the artist, and I really thought about this for now really the nearly 20 years that I've been writing, it's not only the personal individual journey of the artist, it's often the meanings that accrete around that journey. It's the kind of receptions it's had. So when you're looking at an artwork, you're looking at a whole range of factors. So perhaps one needs to have different kinds of conversations to get a sense of what's going on. About how this is to be done, how the sensibility is to be cultivated, that is an uphill task. But I have a feeling that it's going to be done not by one centralized agency, but by a whole variety of platforms and occasions, such as this one, such as what goes on in a structured way in the university. Really, no. I mean, there's no blueprint for how this is to be done. All I can see right now is a whole spectrum of activities from rigorous, demanding academic work to just helping people look seriously and in a more informed way at artworks. But the base of all of this would be that you take artworks seriously. I mean, I have to say, saddened, I think, Githi will agree, by the way in which people who are excited by art are excited really by being excited. Sort of take that one step further and say, oh, what is it that excites us? Or then there's some desire for an antiquated primer of, you know, line, color, form. Useful for a school kid, maybe, but surely not for someone who's looking seriously at art. I know this helps in some measure to answer your question.
Do you have a blog or something? I think we should.
That's interesting. I think our critics haven't taken to be bloggers yet. I think we should start.
I would propose that.
I think at the end of this evening we should propose
that. Would be another platform for engaging the stakeholders.
Sorry, now the evening is taking over and I'm asked to announce that there will be cocktails. Where are the cocktails, Sanjay? Inside, outside? Full moon! Can't we have it outside? Full moon is Purnima today as I was driving. Fantastic, bewitching night outside. But anyway, Cocktails are being served, and if there are no more questions, we are...
Can I ask a quick question?
You're quick, then.
I'm Anup Kamath from Matters of Art.
From which?
Mattersofart.com. I'm an artist too, but here we were talking about only one work, but this could be another discussion. The question is, have you come across other works of Atul which are equally exciting or more exciting? I'm particularly mentioning the latest series of works he has been doing. Shabari series, which...
I'm actually excited by large numbers of paintings. I mean, there are many, many paintings by Atul, by Natraj. I mean, I can name 25 artists whose work I love. But since this occasion demanded a particular thing, then, you know, I just sat down and chose something which evidently has some deep resonance for me, but which I suppose also, it's the kind of painting that allows you to see what paintings can do. And there can be a certain ambition in their conceptual scale, how they can enter different sorts of debates about art making and deal with all of those issues. So that was the reason I chose this particular work. I mean, I might have chosen any number of, out of at least 10 or 12 works that I had in mind, but this is the one I chose. The other part of your question is, do I still respond to Atul's work? Is that what you're asking?
No, I was asking, do you find this political undercurrents or whatever you're talking about in
the Shabari? The Singapore work that I keep thinking of. Yeah. I think that his.
I couldn't really read through that show, I mean, or paintings. I mean, you tried hard, I.
Let me put it this way. I think a suite of work like Antler Anthology sharpens in the space of, what is it, about 12 or 15 frames, literally, paintings, questions of language, emotion, hate speech, the perversion of poetics, all of that. So these are very, very powerful political questions that he deals with. What seems to happen in the Shabari set of work sequence is that the artist is torn between two different things. One is the great opportunity afforded by being able to work at the STPI with technicians and specialists of different kinds. So the expressiveness he really lets rip with the expressiveness. So that might tend to obscure even the politics of what's going on, his concerns with, say, with women or with the figure of the tribal or the subaltern. So all of those political interests are present in the work, but what you see as a viewer is the sheer delight of possibilities available to the artist in that particular situation. So again, you have to see where that particular set of work comes from. But again, for viewers of art, it's interesting to look at why this happens, to look at that tension between expressiveness and criticality.
Well, if I can now just conclude this series and referring back to the painting talk, and for helping us on this whole question in the past, this enigmatic position is, for me, the most interesting part of the painting that has come up. But your question of Shabari actually brought to mind how, I just wanted to say this as if you don't mind, that I saw these Dodiyas at the gallery opening, not Bose Space, yeah.
It was at Bodhi.
Bodhi Art Gallery, splendid gallery in New York, and I happened to be there last year. So I just quite interesting that a lot of people came up to me because I was one of the few people in a sari. They said, "What does this mean? It's all about shirts." And immediately I began to think, you know, I think Atul, one of the concerns that has come up today is the commodification. There's an underlying concern. I think we have to admit it. There is an underlying concern. Parul brought it up in a different way. She queried it, questioned it. But I think there is this concern. I think Dodiya is deliberately playing on that in this.